What's up, everybody? Mike Tony here, and today we're going to be doing another artist critique. So I put out a request for anybody who wanted to get some critiques, and I got a bunch back, and I really want to thank you guys and let you know I really appreciate the support and you guys kind of interacting with me and everything else. So we're just going to jump right into it. So the artist that sent this work in, his Instagram name is orec01. Orec01, you can see it here on the top of the screen. You can go and check out the rest of his work. He does some cool stuff where he takes real people and then superimposes artwork over it and so on and so forth. So make sure you take a look at his stuff. All right, so just to start off, just kind of want to talk about what you know, is actually working for me. So I like the guy's character design. Purple and orange are complementary colors, so they go well together. I like the idea of what's happening here. You know, like the spirit of the wolf. I know this guy is changing into a werewolf or adapting to something like a wolf. You can see the same matching color in the eyes. You can get a really intense expression, which, to be honest, is it's really hard to do, especially early on. And, you know, I still have a lot of issues with that. Getting intense emotions into face and off here. So now let's jump into a couple things that I feel like I guess practice and work on. One, the piece of art is it's seeming a little bit flat, and it doesn't seem like it has a lot of volume. It doesn't seem like it fits within a space, and a lot of up-and-coming artists go through that a lot. I still find myself doing it when I'm doing particular poses and stuff like that. You'll get certain arms or legs that seem really flat and they don't have volume, and a lot of that comes from not really wrapping your work or not understanding the technique of wrapping your figures. So I'm just going to show a little bit of that right now on Orec's actual image, and then I'm going to jump over to a clean space and actually show you kind of a way I would have approached this. So a technique I like to use to give my artwork more volume is wrapping, and that's just simply taking a line, you know, following the line of whatever your arm or your form is, and then trying to, you know, create U's within it, upside down U's or just the U shape. And what that does, you can immediately see it kind of gives it this volume, it gives it this cylindrical shape, the cylinder shape. And the way you kind of do that when you start adding clothes and everything else is you want to add those cylindrical U's to certain parts of the clothes. So right here where the sleeve is, you do a U here, and then it starts to give the idea that the arm has volume. Right where the end of the sleeve is, you do that U here again, and then now you start to get this arm that feels like it's sitting inside of a space. This will also help you inform your shadows and stuff too. So you know that the crest or the high point of your cylinder is here at the center, so you know that any light that's from the top is going to cast a shadow to the bottom. And this is going, you know, every little piece you're drawing sits within a 3D space, you know, unless it's stylized. But if you're going for something that's a little bit more realistic, every part of it does. So you actually see that Orec did that here with the collar, where he gave it some volume and it looks like it's standing in a 3D space. And you know, these straight lines are just simplifying that U form that you use, you know. So you can see that he used it here, he's getting the idea of it, but now you have to translate that onto everything. So whether it's the chest, which is going back into space further away from you, so you're kind of doing an upside down U, then as you can see it's kind of going further away now, and then you could take that all the way across, you know, the simple forms you use to create the human form. So you know, the cylinders for the arms and the square for the body, the same thing still applies, and for the head as well. It's going back into space, and now you're starting to see that you're getting eyes that could potentially be looking up and instead of kind of forward in this out of perspective view. This is just kind of a start that will kind of help you you know, go back and fix and reiterate on some of your sketches and your work. And if you think about every little piece within your artwork, like, you know, the belt buckle, if the person has a cell phone, their cell phone, the buttons on a jacket, the pockets, you start to see that these things are now fitting in a 3D space. And then you start to look at how can I wrap this thing to give it a form? And that's what I think is kind of missing here. And then we all know that we have every single one of us could always work on anatomy and stuff like that. So, you know, your elbows seem to kind of be in the right place. This arm seems to be longer than the other. And I think with volume, that will kind of change. So, you know, learn the basics of, you know, the anatomy. I'll do a quick six head here, you know, where things are kind of supposed to sit. There you go. The reason why I put the arms out here is because they actually sit under a collarbone, where the thing is. Won't go too much into detail with that. But, you know, keep this in mind all the time, even when you're working in perspective, when you're working in force perspective and stuff like that, because it will, once the anatomy starts getting wonky, because as humans, we see other humans every day, we really can focus on the things that are going wrong in images. And that's the whole reason why we kind of try to focus on getting it as close to as possible, you know, before it's kind of stylized. Because then that way, the person who's watching it can just simply focus on the action or the story or kind of whatever narrative you're trying to paint. So just make sure you practice that a little bit each day, and that should help you gradually improve as far as like understanding the form and going a little bit in with the volume. So I'm actually going to redraw what you have here to the right. And I'm going to try to do it as best I can without making this like a super long video. So, yeah, just bear with me. So actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with the chest. So here I'm going to do like this basic kind of square puppet. And what I'm going to try to show you is like the different planes of the form. You know, the more you practice this puppet in anatomy, you'll understand the different planes of the human body that's going to be showing when you're doing certain things in perspective or when you're trying to move the human form around. So the character looks like he's leaning back, like he's almost screaming, like he's writhing in pain a little bit from turning into a werewolf or some form of an animal. And so what we're going to do is, because he's bending back, we're seeing the bottom of the rib cage, which I'm using this square to kind of symbolize. And because we're looking down at him and he's leaning back a little bit, we're actually seeing the top of the pelvis. And like I did in my 3D forms video, these things still sit in our 3D universe, so we have to make sure that the lines are, you know, going away in perspective as we're doing this. So as you can see, as the pelvic is going down, I do have these lines here going inward to kind of show that, and that's how you're getting that idea that okay, I'm looking down at his human form, I'm looking down at his body, and I'm assuming his legs are kind of back. Now wrapping here, the legs look like they're kind of facing out a little bit, and I'm having a problem with it. So what helps me is if I do this kind of coil wrap method. As you can see, you see now the leg starts to look like it has more volume. It starts to give me a guide of how big I can make the leg and where it's actually going to be going in its space. And just like that, you know, that really helps, even though the legs are slightly uneven. And then part of me bending his body back like this is because I've done a couple of studies, not exactly like this, but just like human body studies, that I kind of have a little bit of an idea about the way the body kind of moves. and if the person was straining, you know, how far they would be leaning back. And that's just simply doing life drawings and practicing that. There's a lot that goes into art. You know, I 3 years ago when I decided to start, you know, taking my art seriously and drawing every day, like I didn't realize how many things I would have to cover on a day-to-day basis to just create one character. Life drawing is huge. Even if you're drawing, you know, you have a drawing style like Cartoon Network Steven Universe, you still have to understand the things the body can and cannot do within, you know, your own universe. You have to understand the rules so you can know how to break them. And doing a life drawing is huge for that. And you don't have to do it like make it look exactly how you're doing the study. You don't have to do that. The idea is to really, is at least in my opinion, so the idea is to just understand the gesture, understand the feeling of it that you're getting from it. So you see a lot of people that will do studies and they draw the studies in their own particular style. And, you know, that still is helpful. You don't have to draw it line for line and make it a perfect copy or reproduction of it. You just have to understand and get the idea of what the gesture is trying to display. And for a long time, I didn't want to do that. I didn't like drawing from study and stuff like that because I'm like, I'm not drawing the things that I want to draw. Like, I want to draw a guy getting punched in the face or, you know, someone jumping from rooftop to rooftop. Like, I don't want to do this. And, you know, I was talking with my cousin who's a really, really good artist. And, you know, he was like, yeah, you don't have to draw it, you know, like exactly the way it's supposed to look. The idea is, you know, you want to get the feeling of what that's like. You want to get the motion or the emotion from it, and then do it in your own way, depict it in your own style. Whether you do these really big round eyes like Powerpuff Girls or something like that, or you have more of a realistic style like Berserk, you know? And that really helped me because then, you know, I wanted to start doing it. It started to make me, it became a challenge to say, okay, well, I'm gonna do, you know, a couple of life drawings, a couple of life studies, and I'm going to try to do it in an anime style, but I'm actually going to try to keep the same, proportions. So I'm going to do an 8-head really realistic human, and then I'm going to actually try to put an anime face on it or try to do these anime style clothes. And it just became interesting. It also let me like figure out what I kind of liked. It also let me learn enough about certain body parts and gestures that I can actually develop my style more because I knew what to exaggerate and I knew how I wanted to exaggerate it. And yeah, it's been a big help. I at least once a week will go to YouTube and go to New Masters Academy, which is an awesome YouTube channel. You should definitely subscribe to it. And then, you know, once a week, do one of their life drawings. And I honestly feel like after I do one of those life drawings, that my work grows significantly. And I always find it as a really awesome help, especially if I like don't know what to draw. You know, a lot of times you're like, oh man, I really don't know what I want to do. I don't know what to draw. But you should draw something at least once a day. Just go to New Masters Academy and do one of the life drawings there, or figure drawings. And I can guarantee you that like it will make the difference, even if you're doing it once a week or even once a month, because you just have to adapt. You have to adapt to, your skills have to kind of catch up to what they start to. And no matter, just remember, no matter how it looks now, it won't always look that way. that it will, you know, improve the more mileage and the more work that you bring into it. So I'm actually gonna try to throw some clothes on this figure really quickly and hopefully it'll come out good. So you got to remember consider that your clothes are kind of moving around, flailing around, that there's wind or whatever it is, or any type of power your character is like going through, and just add a little bit of dynamic aspect to your character's clothes and folds and stuff like that. If you make them move around in the wind or something, it adds a little bit of motion. Just consider that when you are doing any piece of artwork, even if you're doing a comic book and stuff. Even if you're in a room and the air is still, if your character is moving or creating a motion, then it's probably leaving the clothes behind to a degree. So if he's moving his arm left, then the clothes are probably going to be a little bit further behind and to the left, and that gives it a little bit of emotion. As you can see, I want it to look like his arms are raising up, so his arms are actually connected to the top part of the cloth and the bottom part is hanging. And the only way I can say you can learn that and get a better understanding of that is draw from life again. Just make sure you're doing those life drawings. And you know, you're doing naked life drawings as well as life drawings with people with clothes on and stuff like that. If you can't get to a computer and you like to draw traditionally, you can still do the same thing. Grab a fashion magazine, like a GQ or a J. Crew magazine or something like that, and then just draw it from cover to cover. That's something that Phil Barassa messaged me on Instagram. He's the dude that does the character designs for Young Justice and DC and stuff like that, and a lot of those shows. Excuse me. And I asked him. I said, you know, I asked him, look at my work and how can I improve? And he said, look, get a fashion magazine, draw it from cover to cover. And I'm like, from cover to cover? He's like, yes. And you'll get a better understanding of how the clothes sit on a human form, as well as, you know, weight. The understanding the weight of a person, you know, when they are when they're standing, or they have one hip raised, or, you know, if they're doing one of these weird little funky fashion moves and stuff like that, you will start to understand that more, and you'll be able to bring that into your artwork. And I really appreciate that that insight he gave me, because I do practice that a lot. Even if it's not from a magazine, I will actually practice it, you know, digitally. I have a Pinterest where I have, like, I don't know, 28 boards, and all my boards are a little bit different, and I have a studies board and a clothing board and a life board, so I can draw, get real life drawings and stuff in. I think it's been huge in my growth and allowing me to grow, is like compiling my own references that I can go back to whenever I need to
and improve upon them each time.
Okay, now I'm just gonna go on this one quick time. Once again, if you guys like the video, please hit the like button, break the like button, and hopefully share it, and maybe it might help somebody else. I really appreciate the support if you guys are still watching at this point. And Oreco One, thanks again for submitting your work, man. Like I said, I like the outfit the character is doing. And you know, a lot of the stuff that you have to work on is something that all artists are constantly working on a regular basis. So you know, that journey almost never ends. Just constantly working on anatomy, constantly getting better at the creating the right feeling for your character, and, you know, the right perspective. And, you know, the greatest of artists, if you follow them on you know, Instagram or Twitter, they're constantly talking about their struggle with the same exact thing that you're struggling with. So don't be discouraged, man. Keep drawing, because that's really the only way you're going to get better. And you definitely will get better. I am a testament to that. You can go to my Instagram, scroll back 30 weeks and see the difference in my art 30 weeks. Some of my friends will tell you can scroll back 2 weeks and you can see the difference in my art in 2 weeks. And all I can say is, you know, put pen to paper every day and you will 100. I can guarantee that you will see improvement. Yeah. So just stay motivated and focused. I'm actually gonna do some folds here inside the shirt. I didn't touch upon any real anatomy here. I'm just doing that surface level because I'm thinking about doing kind of a quick proportions and anatomy tutorial. I really only want to make it like 8 or 9 minutes. And hopefully it'll just be like a jumping point, a base in which like you can go and take it into a more serious study. Because to be honest, like you can't, I mean, it's a whole college course, anatomy. You know, it's a whole college course to barely get it and to understand it. So there's no way, you know, I can make a real comprehensive and or a really good one, considering there are other artists out there a million times better than I am for YouTube. So I just want to help people to find a good starting place. Say, okay, where can I start with this whole anatomy business and what should I kind of be considering? Because it can seem overwhelming when you think about anatomy as a whole and all the different things that you have to learn. You know, just even in the neck alone, and I think it's the sternal mastoid or something like that, and how your traps connect to that from behind, and how that I think it's sternal clidoid mastoid or something like that, cleidomastoid, goes behind your jaw, and you know how that informs how the jaw moves and how your neck turns. Like, it's some deep stuff, so you got to learn that gradually, and you just got to take it legitimately a step at a time. Start off with the puppet, try to get the proportions right with the puppet, then you go deeper deeper and deeper and deeper into the details as you master each level and in each stage of the game. So that you got to keep that in mind, even with all your different types of drawing, is starting off with big shapes, starting off with the most simplest form, and then whittling it down and taking it to another level by going deeper and deeper into detail. You don't want to start off with detail, because then one, you just get burned out, and two, you tend to get so lost in your work and stuff that you tend to not want to erase or change certain things, the same way I'm doing with this head, which is clearly too flat. Here we go. Do not be afraid to erase your work and start it again, because redrawing it is only going to make it better, and it's only going to give you more practice. So if you gotta erase it to make it better, erase it to make it better. There we go. That's a little bit better, but it's not perfect. I would probably work on this for another 20 more minutes, just mess around with the head itself for 20 more minutes, but we don't have that type of attention span now. Nose here. And I'm actually going to give him kind of these curved eyes, so he's looking like he's in pain, like it's almost sorrowful. It's like, this is painful. Okay. All right, guys, I appreciate you watching OREC01. I hope this helped you. If you like the video, guys, again, please like, share, and subscribe. And don't forget to draw every day. Peace.